what business you're in, a pitch is something that as a business owner you're going to have to get comfortable in doing. So we're lucky tonight to have some people that can give you feedback besides everybody here. Bill's agreed to stay, so he's going to give us some feedback on pitches, myself as well. As you guys know, I like to talk, so I'll give you some advice on that. We don't laugh that hard. As you guys can see, we have Action Coach Garth is back with us today. And for those of you that don't know, John has been with us since the session one, helping us run the tech side. He has also run an entrepreneurship at the college for how many years, John?
I started in 1984 teaching entrepreneurship at the college.
So for a few years, he's done that. And so all of us will be able to give you guys some feedback on those pitches.
I'd just like to say at the end of my courses, I always recommend two things. Number one, keep in touch with Community Futures. There are some great people there, and they'll be a great resource. And the other thing is make sure you keep Bill Halley's business card. You can buy him for a cup of coffee, and I totally trust him. For many years as an administrator at the college, if I said, Bill, can we go for lunch? I'll buy you lunch. I just want to bounce some ideas off you. He was too big of a deal to go for lunch with little me, and now he's available to you. And you can get him for a coffee. He's a great resource, and I totally trust him. So you met a great person and a great program. Thank you.
All right, guys. So keep in mind, this is going to be short and sweet. Is the hope 5-minute pitches followed by about 5 minutes worth of feedback, and all of you can take something away from that. So as you guys know, I'm not going to do any introductions beyond the names. So let's have a big round of applause for Carl.
Hi, I'm Carl Nyberg, and I want to start a business selling board games that I've invented. So the company is going to be called Play Nice Games. So what usually happens when you play a board game, say it's Christmas time and you're together with friends and family, and you break out Risk or Monopoly, and you play a few turns, and you play a few more turns, and you play a few more turns, and pretty soon it's 3 hours gone and there's still no winner. You know, so that's a problem that I want to solve with at least one of my board games. So this board game called Hero's Path, everybody starts as a hero and you move through different parts of the board. And the main thing is that it plays in about an hour. You know, there are other board games out there with heroes that go on an adventure, but it takes up to 3 hours to play them. You know, so that's what I'm aiming for in this game, is one of those types of games, except for that plays in about an hour. So with Risk and Monopoly, usually what you do, well, with Risk, you start with a certain amount of territories and you try to gain more and more territories. And Monopoly, you start with, you know, you start going around and around and you try to gain more and more properties. And with this game, you're the hero and you go either into the forest or the desert or different places, and you draw different cards based on, you know, where you go, and different things can happen to you. So what if you were a hero in a far off land? So that's one of the heroes from this board game. Her name is Heather Huntress. You see she has a bow and arrow and she's ready to take something on. So a bear could attack her in this game. So in this game, if you go to the forest with your hero and you draw a card, one of the things that can happen is a bear could attack you. So the different heroes have different abilities. And this particular hero can summon a dog to help her, a hunting dog. So the hunting dog will help her take on this bear. And so that's one of the things that happens in one of the turns. In this particular instance, what you would do is you would roll a die for the bear, and then roll a die for the dog, and roll a die for the hero, and then whoever gets the higher roll wins. You know, and then you'll gain some gold, and then you'll advance to the next turn with more gold. So, you know, you'll work your way up towards the end goal, which is retrieving relics. You know, which cost a lot of gold, or you can defeat villains to get more gold. Okay, so what I was planning on doing with this is there's a company in California called BoardGamesMaker.com where they'll make any number of board games for you, from one to, they say on their website, to a million plus, you know. So, although, you know, if you make less, it costs more per unit. So I was planning on using them to make my board game. And then selling it online at Amazon.com. At Amazon.com, you have a little portion of their warehouse, and if you sell out your portion every month, then you don't have to pay rent. You know, so it's something to strive for to get good sales. My target market would be just people who like board games. You know, people who like adventure games. And secondarily, I'll want to market it to families, you know, because this particular game is family friendly. I would guess you would have to be around at least 12 to play it to understand it, but you know, that sort of thing. And that's a picture of another hero in the game. That's it.
Started. I liked it. I liked a lot of things that you did. I thought you started off really, really strong. What I would love to see if this arena, this is something Bill and I talked about a little bit earlier. When Bill went through and talked about what was in a business plan, the heart, the mind, and the wallet, I really think a pitch should follow that. And I think you did that to a degree, definitely. What I would love to see if this arena, you know, in telling you what I would love is how many people have flipped over a Monopoly board or seen a Monopoly board flipped over. Throw a picture on there, Google it, because everybody has seen that in their life, a game that they played with their family or their friends for hours, and then they just got so mad at the end. And I think that you're so close to touching that heart portion of it. So I'd recommend kind of changing that portion a little bit. I would also, in terms of things that I'd recommend that you add in, a little bit more info on especially the market itself, because I think that this market is really growing right now. And I think there's a lot of indicators out there that show why it's growing, and I think that would be really good. The only other thing, and then I'll let someone else talk, I think it would be really cool, especially if you have a game like this, if the rounds are really easy, get a couple of people and actually take them through a round of the game as they play, and then that way they kind of get involved in it and people will see how easy it is to kind of pick it up.
Yes, that's good.
I'll throw in my two cents. So he's a nice guy, I'm not. So I'm gonna say, I appreciate what you did here, but you never gained my attention. Like, I get it's a board game, I get that, but you need to grab my attention by, you know, something. You have to get my attention. I looked at it, and the way it was, to me, the way it was explained is there's a lot of complexity. You know, if you do this, you get this, and you do this, and you get that, and you just gotta make it easier for simple guys like me to kind of figure that out. For me, you talked about the time of the game, but you never talked about the time of the game. Like, how long is this game supposed to run? Is it 1 hour, 2 hours, 4 hours? I mean, Monopoly could go on forever. I get that, but is there a time limit on this game?
Yeah, it's about an hour for three people.
Okay.
Yeah.
He said that?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, because I never heard that, so that's good. Thanks for the clarification on that. And then I guess I look at it, and I look at when Bill talked earlier about knowing your numbers or needing your numbers, it would have been nice to have the numbers just laid out there. You know, like, this is what the game is going to cost. You know, and kind of walk through the numbers of the game. And you told a great story about the game, and you basically came across and you said it's marketable to families, and then you said 12 and up. So it's 12 and up. Is that the whole idea behind it? Okay, cool. Other than that, yeah, it was good. You need to jazz it up a little bit and grab my attention and kind of bang on the table. Got to get my attention, but that's cool.
Okay.
Awesome.
Cool.
Well, I thought it was just perfect. I don't know what I'm saying, because you're my brother.
Couple of points. You talked a lot about the game. Didn't talk a lot about business. How are you going to make money? And when you go, you're going to go to this board maker to make some of your game, right? When I think about that, it's like me saying, I've got an idea for a car. I'm going to go to BMW and get them to make it for me. Right? Are you kidding? I mean, you can't go from the zero to like 100. How are you going to do a couple of iterations that limit your expenses, limit your cost to get it to a point where you can go to maybe a user group and try it out, then you do some refinements, try it out, to the point where you say, oh, this is at that 80% point, then I'm going to go to the board makers and get them to do, because that can be very expensive.
Oh yeah, for sure. I've actually done a whole bunch of play testing with this game already. Like, I've I've tested it with friends and strangers, and you know, the one friend of mine always tries to break my games. You know, he tries to try different strategies that make the game unplayable, you know. And so this particular game that I talked about, it's quite well tested already, and I've just done
that.
Yes.
Make sure you say that, because otherwise you're leaving me to think that you're still in this developmental stage, right? Mm-hmm.
And I was just gonna say, do you remember when we talked about market research and we said that when you're doing market research and you're presenting, assume that the person you're presenting it to is in the eighth grade. I would recommend that you do the same thing with the people that you're presenting to. And it's tough with 5 minutes, and it's tough because you're first. But you know, and I mean, everything else aside, I think this was a good presentation, especially for the first presentation. So I think that if you make those few changes, and is this a drop shipper that you're dealing with that makes these games?
What's a dropshipper?
So a dropshipper is someone like you just pay them and then they slap your name on it. You don't pay for inventory, essentially.
No, well, you send them your artwork too, you know. So
they put all that on there.
Yeah,
but are
right.
You actually paying for inventory? Or do you just pay them from your sales sort of thing? You just, if someone gives you a ticket for $100, say, you just give 40 of that to them?
Oh, no. I'll be ordering sets of games from them. So I'll have to find a place to store games.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Hopefully you're doing this all under some form of an NDA, right?
Yeah, of course.
Well, you'd be surprised how many people don't, my friend, because they trust people, and then it's all good until you start to make money. And then people start to think that, how come I see a patent for this idea that I invented? So remember, folks, in patenting, and the rules today, it's not the first to invent, it's the first to file. So you can invent something, someone sees it, they file it, they get the money, they get the license. So, but hey, I like your enthusiasm.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay. All right.
I don't even have to say anything.
Hi, everybody. For those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Kirsten. I'm the silent partner hiding behind the computer at home. I'm Karen. And our business is called Paw Time. So I don't know if any of you in the audience are dog owners, but I have two beautiful little beasties at home. And I have thought about this before, but just recently, with our really bad weather this winter, I found myself wishing that there were somewhere for me to be able to take my dogs to play with them inside. So I looked around, did a little bit of research, and we have doggy daycares, but there's nowhere that I can actually take my dogs and play with them or watch them play.
I'm a mother and I'm a workaholic. I have not been able to have my own pets for some years between work hours and renting. So I've dog sat for everybody else. I go stay at their house, take their dogs out. I'm also a long distance runner. So one of the problems I come into is I'm taking care of someone else's dogs. I'm not gonna trust them off leash. I don't know where all I can take them because I don't know how they're gonna always interact with other animals. So it would have been nice in all these years to have somewhere to take them that I could trust, that would be safe, that I didn't have to worry about coyotes or other dogs attacking me.
So with the research, there's 3 off-leash parks outside in Lethbridge that obviously don't cost you any money. There's 2 fenced-in ones. So some of the problems we have is we've got a lot of recent coyote activity. I don't know if you've seen anything on Facebook about it. There's rattlesnakes on the north side and on the west side, and there's high coyote activity at the scenic park one. So there's also, you know, mosquitoes and bugs. Your dog can run into porcupines. You also have to comb your dog for ticks after they run outside because we have a big problem with that here.
Let's not even mention the weather that we deal with in the city, from very hot to very cold in the same day.
So different dog breeds, they can't take the high heat in the summertime. There's ones that can't take the cold in the winter. So what we would like to open is a larger scale, 7,000 to 10,000 square feet indoor dog recreation center. We would have a section for the larger dogs and a section for the smaller dogs. We also are going to offer daycare services. We also noticed that the daycare services were very limited in Lethbridge, so we would like to offer extended hours, starting early in the morning and going to about 10 o'clock at night, weekend services, Saturdays and Sundays and holidays. Our goal is to offer memberships, so you can get a monthly membership. You get a key fob, 24/7 access, kind of like a gym. So after our hours, there's security system set up and security cameras so we can see when you're there. But if you work shift work or you are late at night and can't sleep or your dog needs to go exercise and you don't feel comfortable walking around your neighborhood at night, we can offer you that service. We also are going to offer the daycare, services, drop-in fees. So there's either drop-in fees for one-time service or your monthly membership where you pay us every 2 weeks and have unlimited access to our facility.
Yeah. And then we would also have, did you mention the dog wash? Dog wash, the separate areas. What am I forgetting?
I think that's it. Yeah.
That's it. But yeah, and then the big seller, in our opinion anyway, is having that option of being able to go in at any time of day or night. There's a lot of people in the city that work for healthcare and in the industrial section that are on 24-hour shifts. They can't go out in the middle of the night. Well, you can. I personally don't feel safe.
I'm not going to.
Yeah, and then don't forget the coffee. We will definitely have a coffee shop.
So that's it.
I like that you guys understand the pains of your clients, and I think that one thing that is really good is that both of you told your story. What I would do, you have a dog?
Two.
Where are they? Why aren't they in the presentation? I'd take pictures of them and throw them in there, right? That's that connection. I think that's what really makes people go, These are my kids. These are the dogs that I'm talking about.
Well,
these
I could
are
the have brought ones one,
that...
but not the other one. Yeah.
This is the one dog I like and would take to this.
Well, there's one that actually likes everybody and loves everybody, and there's one that's scared of everything.
Yeah.
So I can't even take them to an off-leash park because when they're together, they don't listen, and the one that's scared of everything doesn't get back in the car. So, we've also ran into porcupines, and we've also been scouted by coyotes. Like, he was so close, he was probably from here to the wall away from me, so luckily my dogs didn't run after the coyote, but I could see how big his eyes were and how fluffy his tail was.
Yeah, so you've seen that, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's really cool, and I would love if that came through a little bit more. One couple things that I would recommend, there were a couple of slides that I felt had too many animations, and I was focusing too much on the slide, and not enough on what it was that you guys were actually saying. And then cost. You mentioned memberships. I'd love to know how much the membership.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
because that was something that you
I did have that in my notes, but
yeah.
I didn't read it. The memberships were $60 a month, and the drop-in fee is $10. And the daycare services, they're pretty standard across the city. Your 5 hours, which is half a day, is anywhere from $18 to $21 an hour, so we're going to put it at $19. And your full day, which is up to 8 hours, is anywhere from $28 to $31. We're putting it at $29.
Perfect.
You had mentioned something just over the course of the program here that you were going to do advertising as well.
Oh, yes, we were going to offer advertising. Oh, I forgot that part too. part of our floor plan is in the bigger dog area. We want to put an inside track so that if your dog isn't good with other dogs, you can walk it on a leash or train it to run without the distraction of the other dogs. And so we're going to put the advertising kind of like a hockey rink on the inside of and outside of the fence.
So that would help keep your cost out to members if you can get your overhead.
Yeah.
So one thing, sorry, you go ahead.
How big will the facility be?
The place that we're looking at is 12,000 square feet. It's pretty big. Yeah.
I liked it. It was good. We had a dog for 14 years, and she was in love with something like this. I didn't feel you ever took ownership. You always said, we would like to. Not we're going to do this, or we're going to have this. You said, we want to do this. If it's your business, say, this is what we're going to do. This is our plan. We're going to do this and this and this. So make sure if you're doing a pitch, I want to know what you actually have this idea, and it's already yours, up, you know, not just up here, but it's out there.
Okay.
So make sure it's like, we are going to do this. This is our plan to do this. Like, don't say we would like to. Just how you word things,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, totally.
And also, too, you didn't say how much it costs. That's what I had to answer, so. I think it's a great idea. They have something like that in Calgary, actually.
They have one that's that, but you don't stay though.
No.
Like you can drop it off, and I've looked at everything, but there's nothing that you stay and interact with your dog while it's there.
Oh.
You still drop it off.
Yeah, we just drop it.
And it's
off.
A big, it's huge, right?
Yeah.
But there's nothing where you stay and interact. The only places that we found, there's one, a small one up in Edmonton. There is one in a couple in Toronto and Montreal and down in the States, but and they're the ones that you stay and you can interact with your dog while you're there. But most of them would just drop off and pick up later.
So you'll never have staff there then? You'll just have...
Oh, no, we're fully staffed.
So
yeah.
What we want to do is I did set up a survey on Facebook and a random 100 people. We're looking at probably staffing at least from 10 till 10 and then possibly from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. Because from... It depends on the day of the week,
right?
Of course. Yeah, Saturdays, Sundays were the busiest by far of what people chose, and I gave them the option to choose as many days and times as they wanted. But from 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. by far was the most selected next to Saturdays and Sundays. So we need to have staff there for the daycare, but also control, you know, make sure things are going well. And then so the coffee shop can be open, the retail can be open, and all that as well.
The 24/7 access is really for like the after hour stuff, from like from 10 at night until 6 in the morning when we're not there. If you work shift work and you need to exercise your dog after work.
Well, I loved your energy. You guys are really good together like that. One last thing, I'm just a little nitpicker things. When you're doing your presentation together, you both have cards, so you know it's her turn to talk. You don't have to go, because you know it's her turn to talk.
Yeah, but we wound up switching almost all of them by accident.
Okay.
Yeah, we were up here. That's
why.
Just the flow. It needs to like, be a nice constant flow, that's all.
We did practice, but I have a bad cold, and I was high on medication this afternoon. So,
And it's also for you guys with the judges. So when you're up here and pitching, I'm thinking, do you guys have insurance, or do I sign a waiver as the pet owner? Is that something that they should, like, how much detail do you put in this? How much do you let you guys ask them questions? Like, you don't want to forget things or...
Well, one of the things I have circled here is liability. Every one of us, and when we start our business, we think everyone's going to use the business, the product, the service, the way it's intended. But people can get sued crazy these days.
Yeah.
You have to be protecting yourself so many times about the things that may not be obvious, but obvious to those who can sue you.
Mm-hmm.
So liability here could be a big issue. So you have to really consider that. Now, there's two parts to this whole story, and I know this is your first place. So it was good, right? So there's two parts to this. There's selling it to me as a customer, and selling it to me as an investor. When you're doing the pitch, I think, for the competition, you've got to think of the whole business you're selling, you have the idea of it. So you're gonna have to talk about the finances. When you talk about staffing, to me, lots of dollars out there. Are you gonna make money? So maybe if I can just go through my little list here. Great presentation as far as the market resource. You got it together, you grabbed the heart, that's for sure. The dog's up there, that's great. I think you've done the research not only in what customers are looking for, what's not out there, but the dangers of the alternatives. So you're bringing something to the customers that they, once they know it's there, they could use. So I think your market research was right on. I like that. That's what got me. I agree, there are too many graphics spinning around.
Kay.
You have to talk, you want to be focused on you guys.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, if you had one picture up there of you and the dog, that would be fine for me. Because you need to remember, once you have all this razzle-dazzle and a bunch of slides, and I walk, my eyes go away from you, and I'm looking up here, and I'm hearing this little noise out there, which is you talking. You really need to focus our attention on you, and that's where, when you refine your pitch, you'll do away with those cheat sheets.
Yes,
right?
Yeah.
Don't use those, because we don't.
I didn't even read mine anyways. I was just holding on to it.
Because there's nothing like a sponge. Even if it doesn't work perfect, there's nothing like a spontaneous presence. Use the body language because that really helps. So when you get into your presentation, I'd like to see a slide on how do we make money, right? So you've got all this advertising, which is good. You get the coffee shop, which is good. Going to take something to set that up. Who do you partner with? You go to Tim Hortons and partner with them, for example, or something like that. What's your revenue stream? How is it based on? Is it based on how many visits, is it going to be visits per week, per day, whatever it is, because you have to cover those staffing costs, which then includes all the liabilities of those staffing, right? And security, maybe if you need security, you might set up cameras and all this stuff, how are you going to respond to this? So you have to think that through. Obviously, when this idea takes hold, there's going to be others out there. I can do that. I'll go and buy a 15,000 square foot building and be bigger and better. So once you get into this, one of your discussion points, it's a slide, is how do you get first to market? How do you get there first, brand yourself, and have that brand name that people recognize that say, I'm going to go there with my dog and my cat, or dogs, mainly dogs, I guess, because I love the place, the word spreads. Some of the best advertising is word of mouth. Mm-hmm. 80% of advertising, especially in small towns, word of mouth. So you think someone's going to copy me, right? So what sets me apart? And it's not just this 12,000 square foot building, it's a raw building, it's heating and cooling and something. There's some attraction to it. Families can come there, maybe there's a play area for the kids or something. But you're not just wanting to attract that dog owner and maybe the family. So sky's the limit for you guys. I love it. It's yeah. Great. Good idea. So you want to grab that market and get out there. Start making money.
You do dog birthday parties in there.
You could. Actually, yeah. Funny enough, we have a pet photographer already interested in working for us.
Before we go to the next presentation, just to address your point, because you're talking about insurance and everything like that, what I would recommend is, because this is a 5-minute presentation, the only reason that the differentiating factor for me, whether or not I would have mentioned insurance, is the fact that you're dealing with something that people care about more than themselves. And so that's where that liability comes in. It's almost one of those things where for some businesses, you don't need to discuss what your liability is. You know, if you're opening a restaurant, you don't need to necessarily say, I have insurance. But for something like this, I think that that's why it makes it an important factor. Because like I said, pet insurance is a new thing, right? Because people love their pets, and for good reason.
Yeah.
Perfect. Website you said?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I'll just leave an extra Chrome tab open there for you.
Okay. Let me just type it in here.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. And then you're good to go.
Okay. My name is Jill, and my company is Geo Studios. I build attractive outdoor studio spaces for small home-based businesses. These dome-shaped structures are easy to heat, do not need a building permit, and will eliminate your office rent expense. The Geo Studio is a 100 square foot accessory building that can be put on your property with a 30-day order installed in less than 2 days. It is highly insulated and does not need any more than a space heater to keep it to room temperature. And because of its size, it is classified as an accessory building. And since there are no hookups, no electrical gas hookups, no gas, it does not need these permits. It's also usable by family members as a play space, a teen hangout, a retreat for parents, an art studio, or just an extra bedroom. And the dome shape mimics larger domed buildings in creating a wonderful audio resonance that is conducive to music and sound. A Geo Studio in a homeowner's backyard will add equity to a homeowner's property. And because it is virtually round in shape, it makes maximum use of its footprint. At 10 foot high, the dome ceiling gives one a feel of openness and spaciousness that can only be experienced. The exterior colors can be used to match to the existing homeowner's house. And the location can be anywhere in the backyard, since window and door spaces and door placement can be any direction based on wind or sun or preferred view. Of the many possible functions that that it has had, it is believed the business hub will find its greatest demand. As a cost-competitive workspace to your downtown office, the Geo Studio will be comfortable, will have skylights, privacy, and with an interior dome ceiling will reflect the buyer's desire for a healing environment. The number of people seeking to start businesses at home remains stable and could increase as economic conditions change. Also, home-based businesses are more recession-proof than the regular bricks-and-mortar businesses, because operations from home are less costly. While the types of home-based businesses vary, there are certain segments into which the GeoStudio will more easily move into, and that being the field of alternative medicine, such as reflexology, craniosacral therapy, massage therapies, hypnosis, and such, as well as a number of higher level practitioners in fields that blend with existing medical science like chiropractors, acupuncturists, counselors. All these share one common thread. They are all person-to-person, one-hour consultations and don't require a great amount of electrical energy or space or waiting rooms or parking. Hence the GeoStudio does not need a full connection to the grid, and a simple extension cord from one's house will often suffice. A small space heater is all I use to power that one. This market presently operates either in downtown office spaces or sometimes at home from an extra bedroom or basement space. Downtown office space renters earn more but are burdened with rent from $300 to $1,200 a month. With the GeoStudio, this expense can be eliminated while maintaining a comfortable, quiet, and accessible space for their clients. For those who already operate in their homes, they might want to increase their profile and create a more professional image while eliminating the concern of people walking through their home. A GeoStudio would also ensure their ability to schedule bookings more freely. You can tour the GeoStudio by calling me. They are, to start, $6,200. They are highly insulated, very comfortable spaces to be in, so feel free to give me a call. Thank you.
What I'll say is I think that you started off strong. I think that honestly, you would benefit more, and I know that this is so weird because I've kind of said the opposite. I feel like you would have benefited more from having a PowerPoint of some kind to point to a couple things. Are you in business right now?
Yeah.
So have you sold these?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay, that's fair. Have these been sold in other places?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Are they manufactured in Lethbridge then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because these are all questions that I had as I was going through sort of thing. The reason that I asked is if you had sold any yet is because I'd love to see some actual more pictures of them.
Right.
So that I can get a better idea what the inside looks like and everything like that. And if what you're going for is that target demographic is that small business owner and you're trying to eliminate that cost, mm-hmm. I would almost change it to directly show what, I mean, if you're talking about this big cost savings, show it. Factor, figure out what the cost is to heat that, because there is a cost. Even if it's a small heater that you run that's like $20 a month when it's minus 40, that's still a cost, right?
Yes.
And so if you can say, hey, throw it in a bar graph, right? Because that's a visual that can really speak to people, mm-hmm. where you can say, this is how much you would spend on an average, you know, let's say a 500 square foot office or whatever it is, mm-hmm. in downtown, that's how much you would pay per month versus this. That's a direct cost savings to you sort of thing.
Yeah.
Okay. My point. But overall, I think you had a lot of confidence and you knew what it was you were talking about. Mm-hmm. I would just do those changes.
Okay, thanks.
I would suggest, I think it was good graphic. It would have been nice to go off Jason to have a picture of the inside.
Yeah.
It would have been really cool. I appreciate that it's only one picture because we're focused on you.
Yeah.
You're doing the pitch. We're looking at you. We're listening to you. We can glance up and kind of see what's going on. So I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. I think you had a great story. I mean, it's a great story of how they're going to be used and what they're going to be used. I guess me, where I come from, is I look and say, okay, how are you going to make money? Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, we have to make money at this. So how many are we going to sell? You went through the story of who we're going to sell them to or who's going to use them,
right.
And how many.
Okay.
At the end of the day. I know the cost is $6,200, but it would be nice to have the story and we're planning for this type of sale.
Okay.
So that's my opinion.
Great.
Just from a pure presentation standpoint, mm-hmm. Is this your baby? This is yours. So this has been in your mind for how long before you actually got one built out there? How many
couple
years?
Couple years.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you know this. Mm-hmm. You own this.
Yeah.
One slide's great, so why are you reading your notes then? You know what you're talking about. You come out in the middle and say that and just show your passion on this project, because this is what you did. This
right.
is your baby.
Mm-hmm.
So give the presentation, like for me, when you go down and read your notes and you got lost, and it's like, ugh.
Yeah.
From a presentation standpoint, just you don't need those notes. You know what you're talking about. You know what the benefits are, the features of it, you know all the good things. step away from your computer and just tell us your story.
Okay, great.
And also from like the legislation standpoint, know your bylaws. Because if you're going to be selling outside of Lethbridge, I know in Raymond, anything over 2 feet, they require a building permit. I put a carport garage thing in, and I had to put a get an actual building permit. So just kind of do your homework before you
right.
you say a lot of stuff, you know.
Okay, fair enough.
So yeah, lots of good questions. So this is all here to help you, right? Good. We do realize that this is your first pitch, you guys. So forgive us if we propose into something that you think is perfect. The liability thing again could be an issue. What's to stop me from taking my propane heater in there and heating the thing?
There's nothing to stop you from doing that.
Well, you better put something on there because you're going to be liable if you don't tell people to specifically do not to do it.
Yes.
And the reason for that is you'd be surprised that, well, I'm going to sue you not because I couldn't do it, but you didn't tell me I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
You know? So that's why you see a lot of things that, you know, danger, plastic, and all that. Even the longer you know, you shouldn't put your finger in a socket.
Right.
And don't do that. So just be aware of that. The other thing is you need to get these out to a market somewhere. Right? Get them out there so you can, even if it means building some, and sometimes that's the cost of doing business. And as much as I hate to say doing freebies, but get some out there you can point people to, oh, the next time you're over at so-and-so, go and look at my building because it's there. Because a lot of people, they like to go and see that, like at the garden show, for example.
Yeah.
They can actually go and touch and feel it, so that would be a good thing. Now, if you're going to manufacture these things, you can, the good news is you could get a whole bunch of orders, right? The bad news is how you're going to make them. Because then you get into how you're going to manufacture these, hopefully en masse, and make money.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a good point you make, because you, one of the questions that we'd always, as a business gets more mature, is what's your cost to make it, what's the cost to sell it, what's the margins, what's the market, right? Because in the end, if you said, hey, this thing is built like a tank, it's great, it doesn't really need to be. But if it costs you $5,500 to make something, you're selling it for $5,600, it's not very much of a margin, right? Because
yeah.
in the end, you've got to make something, make money. So I'd like to see something up there that shows the math. And
okay.
how do you make money?
Right.
But I like the concept. Just like, there is a point, some, again, you may think that, well, you don't need a building permit, like you mentioned. Some places you go to, you know, especially if it's in a park somewhere or adjacent to something, someone doesn't like it. You
I'll save those numbers for you, Bill.
I had just two more things written down. Do you actually have this right now as your own home office?
Yes, that's
okay,
in
that's
my backyard.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
And is what about Wi-Fi? Or, you know, get Wi-Fi no problem in your backyard? Someplace you can't get Wi-Fi.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Well, it's going to be located in someone else's backyard, so they would be dealing with that,
okay.
as far as I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is a really good point. You should
mm-hmm.
make sure that it's accessible for all that kind of stuff too.
Mm.
Depending on your building materials, you may be actually blocking out a lot of stuff. And
yeah. Yeah.
The other thing you may want to consider is you always have to have options, right?
Yes.
Maybe you could put solar panels on, so it's an option for buyers.
A lot of people mention
program
that.
The government tells us we're going to get
yeah.
all this freaky stuff.
That's right.
Maybe the solar panels you put on there on power these things.
It's that's future on down the line, definitely.
Yeah.
Something that size you could sell is can you use reused materials for it?
Well, the spray foam insulation inside, yeah, you probably could use like reused lumber, possibly.
Kind of repurposed materials.
Yeah.
People like to see
these shingles were a discount, I have to admit.
We have time probably for one more comment here.
Okay.
I just have a question. How much right now do they cost as this illustrated in your picture?
This one is $6,200.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Installed in your backyard within 100 kilometers of Lethbridge.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks so
Thank
much.
You.
Well, Well, hello everyone. The time has gone by fast, and my name is Rosemary Nyberg, and I'm a third year management student here at the University of Lethbridge doing an HR and labor relations major. And I'm excited to tell you about job design, the art of smart hiring practices. The idea came to me when I was taking a performance management class, and we talked about key performance indicators. My company would be very technological, and it would really serve it as a business to employers. Now I just, oh, what happened? Sorry.
Yeah, it's all good.
You can just amuse yourselves while we wait. So then, this is the heart of it.
We're taking off the mic.
Oh. Okay, so the idea is that when people have made, okay. So hiring can be a puzzle, and I've used this image of the puzzle to show that that is the employer, and they have a need for a staff member. And sometimes the mismatch can be expensive and costly, depending on if the needs have not been assessed properly. And as every business or organization has mission and value statements, we really need to understand what those are in order to engage in strategic hiring. Now, the human cost of a bad hiring decision causes grief for the employer, having to pay severance or termination pay, and then plus having to hire somebody else to do that job. And then it doesn't create a lot of goodwill in the community when somebody has to be let go because they were a wrong fit for the company. And so the opportunity that I see is to provide business-to-business service delivery and strategic human resources conduit that would be created through some sort of technological apparatus and focus on the achievements of the determined key performance indicators that align with the established goals of the business. So it's really something that requires a lot of thought. And so the problem with a bad hire is I think that sometimes employees don't know what's expected of them either. And so they're stuck in this job, they don't get any performance feedback, and then they don't know what the goals and aspirations are, which is what's possible more with a performance management system as opposed to the yearly performance appraisal. So job design hires on hiring and promotion decisions that build on the established mission and value statements of M&E business, and that it's more focusing on the strategy and really knowing what you want. So I use a chess game because I like that. Let's look at it again. Isn't that nice? And so this whole idea about removing flawed logic, and I think, and this is just from my personal experience, in the last 10 years I've had jobs where people have hired me because they like me and I know a lot of people, and they thought, she'll be a great receptionist, but you know what? I'm not a good receptionist. I'm a strategic person with a green personality, and I love to think and plan. And so while they liked me at the front of their office, it wasn't doing me much good. So this is where the heart comes in. But I was nice to all the customers and very social. Okay, so pinpointing the technical and interpersonal skills required to do the needed job in an efficient and effective manner. What is it that the employer is actually looking for? So what services can I provide my clients to really make sure that they are getting the right fit and they're able to maximize their earning objectives? And so the whole idea is to reduce inefficient hiring practices. And once the person is employed, to make sure that the position is streamlined and efficient. I once had a job working as an executive assistant to a superintendent. I got the job to go from full-time to part-time in 3 months by reducing all the inefficiencies. When the lady came back from her maternity leave, there was a lot less to do. So positive business relationships. And the solution will be implemented and monitored through individualized plans created for each position required for the effective administration of the business. And the plan is to plan for success through goal setting and hard work. And I really want to work hard and have a lot to do. And thank you for listening. And now it's question and answer time.
I think you have a strong presenting style in the way that you are very confident in the way that you speak, in the way that you stand, in the way that you make yourself kind of that central focus. I think there were a couple times where your presentation drew away from you, which I think is a mistake. There were a couple parts where I felt like you were reading off of the slide.
Mm-hmm.
And really, for me, the selling point was your story. When you talked about your experience, when you talked about the fact that, hey, I've gone for job interviews where people have said, you're going to be an executive assistant. And you know that's not the job that you're best suited for, right? And so I'd love to see a little bit more in terms of almost the process of your business, because I like what it is that you're trying to do, you know? But I'd love for you to say, I've been there. I've been hired in wrong jobs. I've seen wrong people hired, and I'm here to help those entrepreneurs. Because you can talk to anybody in this room, and I know we talked about it a little bit. I mentioned a couple times, I love getting people involved in presentations and saying, how many of you in this room are business owners? How many of you have actually hired somebody? Actually, as a show of hands, a real question, how many of you have hired somebody? How many of you have had it backfire?
Yeah, that's the large majority.
Yeah, and I think that's what really hooks people. So I'd love to see more of that in your presentation,
okay.
And I think that it would come across as really memorable and really strong.
Thank you, Jason. I meant to do that, but I got nervous.
It overall was good, though.
I thought you had great energy.
Thank you.
I thought you had great energy, and it's nice when you, like, even going back to the Jess set, that's funny. That's memorable. That's what keeps people attached, right? I like that.
Thank you.
When you turned and started reading off the screens, I think Bill's mentioned we don't want to watch the back of your head.
No, well, no,
it's
right.
Like,
yeah,
it's a turnoff. You know this. You know this. You get this. It's cool.
Okay.
You need to talk to us. And if I could talk from a grade 8er, you need to make those words smaller, because I don't understand half the big words up there. Anything
okay.
bigger than 5 letters, it's way too hard for me. I'm kidding.
I'm just basing it on.
Don't talk your lingo. Talk to a 2-year-old.
I think,
because that way I can get it.
Yeah.
So, other than that, yeah, I thought it was cool.
Thank you.
It was good.
Thank you. In this
room, you can look over there and see your slide.
Right.
As opposed to
looking
back, right? So you don't think. Anyways,
well, I'm
just going to be honest. I don't know what you do. I don't know what your business is.
Okay, well, that's fair. It's hard sometimes to take it out of your head and try to present the idea. So what it is that, I'm learning in university about mission and value statements and the objectives for a business. And so I've noticed that a lot of times when people hire other people, for whatever reasons, they don't think about how this person, this human capital, is going to add to those already predetermined goals. And that they hire friends, or they hire people they know, or whatever, but to really, really assess what the hire need is, and then using technology as a way to assess technical skills and interpersonal skills. Like, I'm surprised, in my role, like, public relations is huge. So a lot of times I come to people for, you know, customer service, and when I have excellent customer service, I am blown away. I tell everybody about it. But those times when people are rude or impatient with you and you're the client, it's really bad. And if I had a business and I had a staff member who was rude to a client, you know, I would think, what is it that this person is not getting in their job? What is it that we can address through a performance appraisal? I mean, through a management system, because if it's only once a year and they're not getting feedback, they don't always know. And maybe they're stressed out, maybe the workload's too high, but I do believe in the goodness of people. And I think that when people aren't living up to the expectations that you have for them, because you've seen their passion and their drive, that there's something wrong in the structure itself, and so you really need to address that.
Gotcha. So from your own life experience, and whether it's going to Canadian Tire and some kids saying, well, I don't care, it's over there, like something like that.
There's
no structure, there's no training, there's no anything, it's just a kid to do a part-time job, or an adult. So these things you picked up in your own personal experience that you think, well, hey, there's got to be a better way of doing this. Is that kind of what you're getting at then, something like that? Or?
Well, I talked to a lot of people,
okay.
And a lot of people have had bad employment experiences because they don't understand what's expected of them.
Sure.
And a lot of employers, too, are like, we had to let someone go today, and we just have to hire somebody else. And it just seems like a lot of unnecessary pain and loss when, if it were just more efficient from the beginning, you know, it could save a lot of grief for employers and employees. Like, I just want more happiness
so
for people.
The question then is twofold.
Yeah.
Well,
how are you going to do that? Are you going to operate as the hiring firm? Are you going to actually do the vetting and say, I found this person that's the right candidate?
No.
Or are you going to go into the business and put the systems in place so that the manager, the owner of that business can do it themselves?
That's exactly it.
So that, I think, is what needs to come across.
Okay, I'll do that. Yeah, it's really to provide a tool for employers.
How are you going to sell yourself? I mean, you said yourself, you know a lot of people in Lethbridge.
Yeah.
Is that network, those connections, is what you're going to use?
Well, it would be for, I went to the Southern Opportunity Business Expo, as sponsored by Agility here, and I met Miss Midhouse from the Dragon's Den, and I pitched my idea to her, and she said it was a good idea, but I'll have to wait for the economy to pick up. And I thought, well, in the next year, while I'm waiting for the economy to pick up, I can really build up the idea while I'm finishing my degree.
So this is where you get the heart part done, right? That was okay.
Yeah.
And you get in the mind part, as they asked. And I'm asking myself, what's the product? What is the product? What is it I buy from your company that's going to help me hire or have a hiring practice that's better? What is, because you mentioned some kind of technology. Well, that's not a product to me. That's just a wish. So what's the product? In your presentation, you've stated the problem, okay, right, so I get that. So with your experience and your knowledge and what you're learning, here's a product. And it's going to do this, this, and this for you if you buy it from me for this amount. So I do understand the cost of hiring and having to let people go, I get that. But what's the product? So in your presentation, you have to be clear on the minds. When you get in my mind, here's the product. It's going to help you make these better decisions. And this is what it's going to cost. This is how I'm going to make money, because it's a business. I know you want to make money.
So, well, thank you.
Yeah, you started off good at that part.
Yeah.
I went away into the theory of what is it, what's the product, and I kind of lost it.
That's okay. Well, the product is to provide a measuring tool for employers, so that when they're hiring somebody, they know exactly what they want. So then I would have gone through with them and really sat down with the employer, and then it would be a bundle package. And then I would provide for them an overall analysis of what I understand their business objectives to be, and then their future staffing needs, and how they plan to fill those, and the wages that would apply, so that so what they have for me is a service bundle that they can use, and then and then I would provide the technology, and maybe I could help be involved with the hiring process through the technical assessment skills. But really, it's more so helping employers think through what they actually need in staff in order to reach their goals, because I think sometimes that part isn't thought out as much.
So what you've got to do is say that.
Yeah. Okay.
But say that in two or three lines in the slide. Yeah.
Okay.
And say it to me.
Yes.
Right? And talk about being a strategic partner with me. Right?
Okay.
Because that's the partnership that I work with you, right? So you captured it all in the lots and lots of words. You put it up there in two or three points. Remember, there is a reason why a phone number is only 7 digits long, because people can't remember more than that. So capture their attention with a few words, a few lines that says exactly what you mentioned.
Okay. Strategic partner, assess your business goals, and help you to find the right fit for your business after a careful analysis of your goals.
Okay. What I would recommend doing too, and because we have one more presentation
yes,
we've got to get to, but look at Obed, that video that we saw, that
yes.
Obed that was brought in about maximum management. You remember that pitch? And
yep.
It talked about the plumber, and it said, this is Joe Plumber. He's dealing with the water leak. I think that something like that would fit really well for you. This is Joe Pizza Shop owner, you know? He doesn't know how to hire, he knows how to make great pizza.
Right.
And so I think that would be really good for you.
Well, this is very, very helpful. Thank you, Jason, Bill, and everyone else in the room.
One more presentation.
Do you guys see the internet?
I'll turn the screens off.
For
oh, you do need it for the website? Okay.
Go ahead and
take it in there. These will turn back on in a second.
Go ahead.
Good evening. Have you ever experienced personally to process an application? Like you by yourself processing an application? Especially so that that application will affect your future. Have you? Because these are the dilemmas of many, many immigrants who wants to come and stay in Canada. I'm Rufa Doria. I am an unregulated immigration consultant. I am a licensed consultant, and we are having an emission errors and emission insurance. So our services are to represent the client, to help the clients in finding the best route for them to come in Canada. But not only for those foreign nationals, like foreign nationals who wants to come and stay here in Canada, but also for Canadian citizens, permanent residents, who wants to bring their families to come here in Canada. So that are our services. We provide the same services as immigration lawyers. However, we are not allowed to act as a representative in judicial courts. So other than that, we have these same services with immigration lawyers. So we are doing exactly the same and having the same output. Think about this. There are about 60 immigration routes for whoever, like processing an international student to come here, processing workers to come over here to work. There are 60 immigration routes to come over here in Canada. And for these people who wants to avail these processes, it's very daunting to them. It's very challenging. So our company, we started our business last July, and we called it Doria and Doria, DED, Immigration Consultancy Services. Both of us are regulated immigration consultants. We are licensed. We are under the regulatory body. We call that ICCRC, who will control our services. So our competence will be examined whether we serve the people in the right way, in the right paths. So, as I mentioned, we started last July, and since then, based on our projection that we can serve maybe around 4 to 5 clients per month, and since then, based on the actual business that we have experienced, we exceeded that projection. So we are our revenue sources, our revenue streams comes from consultancy fees. We are charging $150 per hour for consultation. And it depends upon the streams of the client to come, whether it's an international student who wants to come here, whether a Canadian citizen who wants to sponsor a family or a relative to come over here. We have a range of prices, and it ranges from 1,000 to about 3,000. So based from July to February, we have an average of 2,500 per month in sales. And we also, and in terms of overhead cost, we are only having 1,005, the maximum overhead base, because we have an office. We have an office in the First Avenue, in just across the Park Mall place. So that is our office, and we have our websites. So currently, our competitors, we have three. There are three existing immigration consultant offices here in Lethbridge, and of course, there are immigration lawyers out there. And but our services is not really limited within the region of Lethbridge or area. We have clients from other parts of Canada, and we have also clients from other parts of the world. So far, that will be our status of the business right now. And yeah, so what do you think? Do you really want to process that immigration application by yourself or hire a professional service like immigration consultants like us, which can help you minimize the mistakes and having greater chances for approval. That's all I can pitch for you tonight. That's our business.
So I really like you guys, and I really like what it is that you're doing. I think that one thing that you almost did a disservice to yourself on is that I feel like this issue in particular, when you're talking about immigration, especially now, if you want to pull at people's heartstrings, mm-hmm. man, I think that you have probably, out of all the businesses that we've talked to tonight, you have the most potential to do that. You can talk about your own stories potentially. Yeah. How long did it take you guys? From beginning to end, how long did it take you to get the status that you have right now?
To become an immigration consultant?
Or when you first came to Canada. When you came to Canada, okay.
That's a very good question because that really helps the other clients to see us that we are like immigrants by themselves.
Helps us, right?
And it really helps to for them to tell their to attract like, oh, maybe they are very good company because they are immigrants themselves. Ooh. And this is, modesty aside, this is what happened. Since we opened in July, we processed maybe 4 clients, but most of these clients come early as they thought, like they as they expect. They thought that they will come for about 6 months processing, but they were able to come here in 3 months because of like focus, because of our full attention for the client. So what happened then was, they spread the news, and then we never expect that since then they are a lot of referrals, and then that's the good thing in our business that we are picking up because that's a word of mouth that came over, and then and we are very like thankful for that.
Okay, but what's your story? How long did it take you? Okay, yeah, Canada?
Yeah. So it's to make the story short, I came from the States. Okay, so okay. To come here to Canada, it's from, I graduated my master's in July, and then I was invited by McGill University to proceed my PhD from July, and I was able to start by September. So it's really...
So you didn't immigrate from your country of origin to Canada, you went to the States first and then came
mm-hmm.
to
Canada. Yeah, however, can I add that? However, my brother and my sisters immigrated directly from the Philippines to here, and we processed that one.
Yeah.
And then my mom and his mom came here as tourists most often to visit us for 6 months.
I think the most important thing in what it is you're doing is the people.
That's
and
right.
I would love to see the people that you've helped. If you're looking at getting those funds, and then I heard somebody mention it when you said master's, you didn't mention that you have a PhD.
Yeah.
So you're
not very smart at all.
No, I'm not as smart as, only Bill knows me.
Maybe I can give you some great points.
Yeah.
You talk about the heartstrings, boy, you can tug it there. You know, don't do that stuff. Right up there, too busy.
Mm-hmm.
What you want to do is have some pictures of people that you've helped.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And you can say, typically an example of, and that's what I've got here, the pain. An example of immigration. When I came to Canada, which was a long, 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 long time ago,
mm-hmm.
before the internet, the new young people, there was life before the internet. So it took me 14 months before I looked for the job until I stepped into Canada. It wasn't a pleasant experience. When I came to Canada and Ontario, I was thinking to myself, I'm going to get back on the plane because this is a horrible place.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to that immigration guy, he gave it to me and says, don't do this, this, and this, we're going to put you back in the plane. Okay, this is very nice. So I get nothing, right? That's a story because I lived that story. That wasn't easy. So that's that personal story, right? That,
mm-hmm.
that tells people, here's the problem. Here we come along, and our business plan was to have 2 or 3 or 4 clients, however many it was, and here's the people we helped. And after helping me, these people, we went from 2 or 3, 4 clients a month to whatever, right? So it shows the business is growing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then you're going to talk about the potential, you talk about the dollars, which is good. I mean, you have to talk about the dollars. But I think in your business, you have to talk about the people you've helped
mm-hmm.
as much as the dollars, right? Because your business has obviously a financial component to it, but it's the people you've helped,
yeah.
Right? So you can talk about the competition of the lawyers and all this cold hobby people out there. Not that I don't like lawyers, but you know. But you can talk about that because mm-hmm. that is your competition. Mm-hmm. But here you come along, here's the people. We started out with two or three, word of mouth, now we're getting 10, 20, whatever it is. We're making good money, but the core part of our business is to help people come to Canada because it's such a great country. I mean, what a story like this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. That should be your opening is your own story. On your slide, you can say, this is Susie. She was our first client, and mm-hmm. we helped her. And then you can say, and since then, we've had, boom, just pop up heads, so and so. And it's all your clients you helped.
Yeah,
and I can just see that being so cool and stuff. But yeah.
Yeah,
I actually have data here for our last 7 months of operation.
Mm-hmm.
So we have 115 people who contacts through our website or
directly
who really make a call, and then we have 45 consultations done. That's a half an hour or an hour consultation, and 22 of them were paid. Most of them were just because we're starting, so we kind of hesitant to charge in the beginning, so most of them were just free.
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. and we have 14 cases so far.
Ripping.
That's really signed.
This
with
is all good,
with
good information. You should put it up there.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yes,
and
yes,
talk to
them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We didn't have that.
Yeah. At the very beginning, I thought it's like an elevator pitch that we have
that's what I'm thinking, just five minutes.
Even with 5 minutes, and because again, we're running over time, so we won't say too much longer,
yeah.
but
mm-hmm.
with 5 minutes, if you don't have the time to tell your own story, make people aware of it. And just say, I know those struggles.
Mm-hmm.
I lived through those struggles.
Mm-hmm.
Every single person in this room, at some point, someone they were related to went through those struggles.
Exactly.
And I have it in my website, so that's why I was trying.
Yeah, you raised your hand, my friend, Rosario.
Oh, thanks. We met actually at the Southern
Opportunity
Self.
Yeah.
Yeah. So my question is, I'm a volunteer with the Redom program, and so they said that people have to do this test, an English test, and if they don't pass it, they have to do it again before they can apply for permanent residence, but
mm-hmm.
it's very expensive and very difficult. So do you do that
too? Yeah, that's the good thing that you asked, because it's added value on our service because we try to help them reviewing. Like being an instructor, modesty aside, I can help them. Like our clients ask us on how to prepare an essay, on how to prepare, so we can help that. That is an added value. So if they are our clients, we are helping that on that way.
Just don't be modest when you're making your business pitch.
Yeah.
It's business, right?
Modesty's
go after. let the competitor be modest.
Okay, yeah, my friend.
I went through this. I had a lot of trouble with translations, like because you had to translate a lot of documents, pictures, all that stuff. Postal services, sometimes you have to send documents to whatever. Have you thought about adding that kind of value to your services?
Actually, we have clients from, as I mentioned, from different parts of the world. We have clients from El Salvador who are very, everything is in Spanish. So what we did was we connect to official translators, your designated translators who are accepted by the immigration office. So we are the ones who will try to connect that. Yeah.
So it would be nice, like I think for myself, if I could have went to a place and said, I need this,
mm-hmm.
if you can translate all the documents, get the pictures, everything, because I had to do a lot of on your own.
We will do that, but we have to charge them, like, because this is another service, another charge, so, but we try to facilitate.
Have you set yourself up so that if I'm in Nigeria, and I want to come to Canada, are you going to pop up first if I look for immigration services?
I'm working for that, but I'm trying to connect with, I don't know if I'm doing it right, I'm trying to connect with the Yellow
Pages.
And
Google.
And to help me
ask these guys
being visible to
go to Tetanet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's a good point.
This?
Mm-hmm. We had a client, she spent $8,000 setting up a website. And she was asking us, how come I don't get any traction? No one's coming to my website. So we took him to an analyst in town, and he looked at their website, and they weren't using any of the keywords or phrases.
Okay.
Unfortunately, it was all set up wrong. So they had to spend another $10,000 to do it right. Because, and that's where the art is, setting these things up in your websites, like I say, unless you're really, really good at it,
mm-hmm.
get the right professional to do it. Because if you want to use, so anyone in Nigeria says, I heard about Alberta, Canada, how do I come? It goes right to your website, through all that maze. It takes a lot of analytics to do that. So you need to spend some money, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But then you get people coming to you from around the world, then you can start adding your package of service, whether it be translation services or whatever it may be. But you have to get people to your website. It can't just be a cosmetic website that you think looks good, but your customers look at that and say, it's too complicated for me. It's not telling you what I want.
Yeah, what
there's
I find
a real art to that.
Most effective though is Facebook, because we target
social media.
Yeah, we target clients like we just recently we come to decide that we're gonna have to specialize with international students, because this route is the most highly approved applications.
Yeah.
Very selective audience, but so on my Facebook advertising, I have to target those demography. So it's very effective. So I'm not very concerned for now.
Out of curiosity, with those students, who is your target demographic? Is it the students or is it the parents that are paying for them to come? There's a lot of money with international.
Usually
yeah.
both,
right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. both. Because not everybody can come here. Because they have to have that resources to,
mm-hmm.
to come here. So.
So I just Googled you, immigration consultant, and I never put Lethbridge or anything in there on page one.
Great.
Page one.
Page one on Google.
Perfect. How many down?
Yeah. 1, 2.
Yeah.
Man,
that's
if
great.
You could get to number one.
That's great.
Yeah,
well,
that's
all great.
That's very good.
Really
good. Number three.
Yeah,
three
in our consultation form, we send the consultant's form. Part of that is we ask the client who referred to them, how did they know our
mm-hmm.
business. Maybe 30% says they find it through Google. And
great.
Then, yeah. So.
You have all that information. We're running so... We
yeah.
can spend the next 2 hours talking to you.
Yeah.
Thank you
thank
so
you.
Much. Thank you.
All right, guys, we are done. Session 8 is finished.
Yay.
It's been a long road, right?
Round of applause for Casey.
Man, we're not done. If you guys need anything, we're a month away. I'll be emailing you guys so that I'm going to go through all those prizes with you again. All of you, go and download the handbook. And I talked about it at the beginning, even if you don't think you're going to win, we have that tablet we're giving away, you get that screener feedback that is so important. Put in a business plan. We have 29 days, 28 days. Come in and sit down and talk to me. That's what I'm there for. I don't screen and I don't judge, so there's no conflict of interest in me giving you that feedback. It's totally free, just like Bill, as long as you guys just give us a call in. If you have any questions, get a hold of me. Those business model canvases and value propositions, we're extending that to tomorrow at end of business day. So you want those $300 tickets.